In the next few modules, we will discuss objects that rotate and objects that move in a circular path. Examples of rotating objects are a bicycle wheel and the Earth spinning on its axis. Examples of objects moving in a circular path are a car going around a curve, or again the Earth, but this time considering its orbital path around the Sun rather than its spinning motion around its axis. The motion we've discussed up to this point in the course is called linear motion, and the variables we have used are linear variables for displacement, velocity, and acceleration. We refer to rotating motion and motion around a circular path as angular motion. We similarly have angular variables for displacement, velocity, and acceleration. For example, consider the motion of a rotating bicycle wheel as the bicycle is stopping. How fast the wheel is rotating is its angular velocity. We use a lowercase Greek omega for this variable, and how quickly the angular velocity is slowing is its angular acceleration, and we use a lowercase Greek alpha for this variable. And then, how many times the wheel rotates while stopping is its angular displacement, and we use a Greek delta theta for this variable. The reason why we often use angular variables rather than linear variables to describe the motion of objects that are rotating or traveling in a circular path is out of convenience. For example, it's often more convenient to discuss the velocity of a spinning bicycle wheel in terms of how many times it rotates per second, rather than discussing the linear velocity of, say, a spot on the wheel, as this linear velocity is continuously changing direction as the wheel rotates around, and its magnitude depends on its location on the wheel. Its speed would be greater on the outside of the wheel than it would towards the center of the wheel. As we discuss angular variables, you'll notice they are more closely related to polar coordinates, while linear variables are more closely related to Cartesian coordinates. Now let's look at each angular variable in detail, starting with angular displacement. To describe angular displacement, I'll use the example of a bicycle wheel. Let's say that the wheel rotates from an initial position here to here. Or another way to show it, say there's a patch on the tire here that then rotates to here. We can describe this rotation by indicating that the angle that the wheel rotates by is delta theta, where we call delta theta the angular displacement. And the SI unit for angular displacement is a radian. I'll talk more about radians in just a moment. Notice that the path that the patch follows is here. This is a linear variable that we've been calling distance or path length. When dealing with angular motion, we'll refer to it as arc length and assign the variable delta S to it with SI units of meters. Notice that if we stuck something to the spoke of the wheel here, it would then rotate to here, following this path or arc length. And so we can see that the arc length is different for the two locations, but the angular displacement, delta theta, is the same. This demonstrates the key advantage of using angular variables for rotating objects. The linear variables, like arc length, all depend on the distance that the object is from the rotation axis, or in other words, the radius. But the angular variables, like angular displacement, do not. As I said before, the real power of angular variables is that they describe the rotation of the entire object. Something else to note here is that, by convention, counterclockwise is the positive angular direction. So any angular variable that points in the counterclockwise direction is positive, and any angular variable that points in the clockwise direction is negative. Before we discuss the other angular variables in detail, let's first talk about radians. In general, angular units are used to indicate how far something goes around a circle. Common units to describe this are simply revolutions and cycles. For instance, the bicycle wheel made X number of revolutions or cycles. In these cases, there's just one revolution or one cycle in a complete circle. Another common unit is a degree, where there are 360 degrees in a complete circle. All we're doing in each case is defining how many segments the circle is separated into. So when using degrees, the circle is separated into 360 segments. I'm not sure there are 360 segments in my picture, but you get the idea. Now for radians, a circle is separated into 2 pi segments. So that's 2 times 3.1415, etc., etc., number of segments. Or another way to say it is that 1 radian is 1 over 2 pi, or about 0.16, the way around the circle, which would look like this. So you might ask, why would we use such an awkward number instead of separating the circle into a whole number of segments, like 10 or 100 or 360? it goes back to the definition of a radian that then becomes a very useful equation for us. Here's the definition. A radian is defined as the angle at which the arc length is the same as the radius. So that means when the angular displacement delta theta is 1 radian, then the arc length is the same as the radius. So I'll add these variables to the picture. And so r and delta s are the same length when the angle is 1 radian, as shown in this picture. And when the angle is 2 radians, then delta s is 2 times the radius, and so on. And so we can actually write this down as a useful equation. The arc length delta s equals the radius times the angular displacement delta theta. This equation relates the linear arc length to the angular displacement, which we'll find is a very useful thing to be able to do. But keep in mind that the equation is based on the definition of a radian, so it's actually only valid when the angle is in radians. Also note, when doing dimensional analysis with this equation, radians should not be factored in, just the dimensions of delta s and r. Something that's interesting is that the equation for circumference of a circle can easily be derived with this equation. So here's how. Applying this equation to a complete circle, delta s would then be the circumference, and delta theta would be 2 pi radians by definition. Substituting these into the equation, we then get the familiar equation, circumference equals 2 pi r. Now let's take a look at the other angular variables. We'll find that there are many parallels between the linear equations that we are familiar with and the new angular ones. For linear variables, we know that the average velocity and average acceleration are defined with these equations, and the SI units are meters per second and meters per second squared. Average angular velocity and average angular acceleration are defined by very similar equations, where the average velocity is still the displacement over time, and the average acceleration is still the change in velocity over time, but now we're using angular variables. And then the SI units for angular velocity and angular acceleration are radians per second and radians per second squared. We will also continue to use the sign convention that counterclockwise is the positive direction and clockwise is the negative direction. The last thing that we will do is to build on the previously defined equation that relates arc length to angular displacement. With this as our starting point, we can derive equations that relate angular speed to linear speed and angular acceleration to linear acceleration. So this is how we do it. If we divide this equation by the change in time, it becomes this. And recognizing that delta s over delta t is average linear speed, and delta theta over delta t is average angular speed, then this equation can be rewritten this way, which relates average linear speed to average angular speed. A similar derivation with calculus also yields this result, but with instantaneous values. So now we have the relationship between linear and angular speed, which looks very similar to the equation that related linear and angular distance. Since the original equation required that angular displacement be in radians, we also had the requirement that the angular speed be in radians per second. And now let's derive a similar equation for acceleration, starting with the last equation derived. Take the change of both sides of the equation, or in other words, apply delta to both sides, and then divide by delta t, and recognizing that the change in velocity over the change in time is the average acceleration for both the linear variables and the angular variables, then we wind up with this relationship, which again by calculus can be written with instantaneous values. You may notice that I included a t subscript for the linear acceleration. This refers to tangential acceleration, which is a topic that we will cover in the next module. For now, we will just write it in the equation and explain it later. It is again important to note that the angle must be in radians, so the angular acceleration must be in radians per second squared. So we've covered all of the angular variables and the equations associated with them. Finally, I think it's helpful to see all of the equations organized into a table like this. So that's the introduction to angular motion and angular variables. In the next few modules, we will apply these variables to rotating objects and objects that move in a circular path.